Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to the start of the seventh season of the Artwork Series, which brings innovative artists to Lang to talk about the artistic process. I'm Bonnie Marranca, the curator of the series and a member of the Lang Arts faculty. Tonight, our special guest is a man of many talents that have translated into enduring achievements. It is difficult to know where to start in introducing Jonah Bokaer. I can tell you all the places he has worked, the organizations he has founded, awards he has won, artists he has worked with. At some point, I will do a bit of that. For now, I will simply say that Jonah Bokaer is a master of restraint in a time of excess, a slow philosopher in a world running on speed, an elegant figure in an indecorous society. He was the youngest dancer to have ever been hired by the Merce Cunningham Dance Company, starting there at 18 years of age. That was the beginning of many explorations in dance. Later, he made his own choreographies, nearly three dozen of them. He didn't stop there, but created installations, apps, film, and motion capture works. He studied visual arts and media for a time here at the New School. But his energy moved into the world and led him and a group of artists to found, a decade ago, one of the important artist-run spaces in Brooklyn, Shea Bushwick. And that led further to his co-founding the Center for Performance Research with dancer John Jaspers, also in Brooklyn, and as I understand it, the first all-green building there. And so Jonah Bokaer began a journey as a teenager that has taken him across all walks of artistic processes. The institutions he has worked with support interdisciplinary arts, offering residencies and rehearsal space, and producing events with innovative programming and opportunities for instruction. This is what is meant by the education of the artist. Looked at in another perspective, what we see here is an ecology of a community, the creation of a philosophical basis for artists to be independent and their spaces to generate models of sustainability. No wonder his work has resulted in a Human Rights Award, Bessie Awards, and the support of the New York City Cultural Innovation Fund. This is a form of activism that expands the options of the contemporary artist and the arts community with real-world implications. It is about the work of art. Speaking of the world and work, Bokaer has performed in so many countries as to constitute a contemporary performance map. France, Germany, India, Thailand, Chile, Germany, Denmark, to name just a few locations. His collaborators on dance, theater, and visual arts projects include many of the influential figures in the arts, not only Merce Cunningham, but also Christian Marclay, Robert Gober, Tino Segal, Anthony McCall, Ann Carson, David Gordon, and Robert Wilson. These different tributaries make his art full of different dialects. I am intrigued by the way Jonah Bokaer uses materials. In one performance, I saw him rolling around on the floor in large swaths of white paper, as if they were a brand new shirt. In another, he was handling plaster casts of a human figure and standing in white sand. Another time, he was dancing through 10,000 ping pong balls. Then there was the performance with his Tunisian-born father in a sonic landscape of pre-recorded Mediterranean sounds. This artist works through many forms, but in the way that Roland Barthes spoke of the morality of form. There's no waste. Everything has value. The economy of inspiration is a still point. Jonah Bokaer is a man of the world, a man of his time. He has also been called, and here I'm quoting, one of the mystery men of American dance, end quote. It seems to me he knows a thing or two about what is left unsaid and unseen, and perhaps he will reveal a mystery or two tonight. So I hope you will join me in welcoming Jonah Bokaer.
Hi and good evening. I have a have, I guess, just a couple of things to share, and one of them is a secret. I am a very, very nervous speaker. And I was preparing with my colleague Bonnie and also with Jennifer, who's been super helpful today, and then I was about to send them the files for today, but then I found out our government was shutting down, and I thought, should I rethink this talk or this presentation? And then I found out that a friend's art space was shutting down in Detroit today, too, and I thought, oh, wow, there's a lot of, we're entering October with all of these closures. So I kind of decided to hijack my own presentation. And so when Bonnie invited me to do a talk, I said yes. I love the program that you're in, and I have a lot of respect for the program that you're in. But I thought instead of a talk, we'll do a dance, and then a talk, and then two interruptions. So that's, and this is, I found this sound. It's kind of this, it's this Detroit band called Echo Space. And their space, they're just moving out of their space as we speak, so I'm going to do a little ditty for them. So. So what I thought was that I would play, because I don't want to say that this was improvised or choreographed. It was sort of, I wanted to play my friend's music, because they're part of a Detroit underground music community and ran an artist-run space for about 12 years there. And then I wanted to shift my weight 36 times. That was kind of all that I wanted to drop in there, was just shift the weight 36 times and play their music, because I think they're moving out as we speak. So I thought I'd move through all of you. I want to do our first interruption, and then we can look at slides and we can talk. So if everybody could stand up for a second, that'd be great. And I think we're going to turn to our left, and we're just going to do what, oh yeah, we're going to turn slowly. It's all right. We're just going to, but that was amazing. So what we're going to do is we're just going to together, I mean, a lot of the times in dance, but also just in daily life, we take the space that we're in for granted. So we're just going to do a scan together. So you're going to turn a little bit to your left, and you're going to notice what you notice, but I'm just going to notice with you. So you've got a microphone here. There's an extra microphone. So if you want to interrupt me at any point, there's a microphone over there. We've got beautiful works that I think probably are part of the Vera List collection. We've got a doorway here, and the room is painted another color through that portal there. We've got a piano still further to our left, and it's inactive, it's not being used. So if you want to interrupt again, or more times, you have my permission, you can play the piano. We have these beautiful curtains, which are drawn, and I was noticing how they're lit when I walked in a little earlier. Slits in the curtains, I think we have 5 panels of curtains. And ta-da, we have another microphone. So if anyone wants to chime in or interrupt or join in, that's fine. There's still panning further to our left, there's food. So we have a lot of generous food here and beverages. So I think that I don't want to overstep, but I think you should all have some food after we're done with our exchange. So stay and congregate and have food. Then going further over to the left, we have a sort of beige, orange, tan wall, I think. So yet another color going on. Now everybody look up. And the roof or the top plane of the Wollman Hall is kind of wavy. So there's 2 convex and 3 concave waves in the upper surface, and then 2 slats where the curtains are. Then we look further back, we might see a camera, because this is live going on. So everybody, you could say hi, or you could, however you feel. If you feel shy, you don't have to say hi. Then we have our friends, the technicians, and Chris is here at the Mac, which we're super thankful that Chris is here. These Bryce Marden paintings, there are 4 of them. Actually, they're lithographs. And Bryce Marden, he talked a lot about how the edge is always a part of the center. So, I mean, when I walked in, I was like, whoa, I think I even said to Bonnie or Jennifer, I was like, Bryce Marden's on the wall. And I was reminded how the edge is always a part of the center. Then above Bryce Marden, we have the 2 projectors. One is on. They're DLP projectors. You're going to pan a little further to your left, past the false wall here. And we've got the same shade of orange, beige, tan, except this time it's lit. So that's a little different from the right side. Keep panning left, and you probably see some friends, colleagues, classmates. And then we have the other set of curtains. I think we have more space on the left, so there might be 6 sets of curtains, beautifully lit. And we're gonna keep panning. You could even notice the slats or the points where they don't meet. There are even some stains on the curtains. Uh-huh. Same shade as the beautiful orange, beige, tan. Similar shade, maybe. And then we have the corner over here on the left, and some shadows casting on the wall. We have another portal, which is a different shade than the portal way over to our left. Fire alarm, so it seems like we're all to code, so that's good, we're in good shape. And then more beautiful work from the Vera List collection, which is and their wall texts, which are always handy. And those seem related to the ones where we started. And then we have a screen in front, so we're kind of blocking a little bit of your view of the Vera List collection, but that's okay. I think that we're gonna roll up this panel afterwards, and then we'll see the whole collection. So it's just a little scan, and then we see a desktop which has some things on it. And then if you feel you need to, you can interrupt yet again and you can report a problem. That's this icon right here. And so that's just, I wanted to scan with you because it's good to scan the space you're in. You know, if there's an emergency now, you have all the tools that you need. So I invite you to sit down. You can sit down if you'd like. But it's also, I like talking about dance. I like talking about dance a lot, but I also like doing dance. And I also think it's good to apply our embodiment of space and to read the kinds of space that we're in. So raise your hand if you've been in Wollman Hall before. Yeah, there's a lot that we take for granted just in any room that we're in. Okay, so thank you for scanning with me. And again, if you want to interrupt, you can. The second, and there will be a few more interruptions that I want to introduce, is that I'd like for you to, while we're talking and we're listening, I want you to touch a dance. So what we're going to do here is we're going to pass around a dance called Fifth Wall. So this is a dance on a tablet. And the way that this works is you can actually touch the dance, scroll the dance, you can flip it around, and it'll respond to your finger. So you can sort of play and choreograph the figure as you go. There are three settings and there's a menu on the bottom. So I'm going to give this to you. And we'll start on this side. You can make your way up. And then, so touch the dance as you listen to speech about dance. Okay? Cool. So what I wanted to do today was talk, dance, do a few interruptions, and we'll leave time at the end for dialogue too. And I hope that this is a really brilliant student body and a great institution with a great history, so let's be sure to talk at the end. I wanted to talk a little bit today about, or share some research that I've been focusing on about the ways that visual reasoning and dance collide on stage and in gallery and in public space. So that's sort of the framework I wanted to propose. I wanted to start by talking about, I have a friend who lives in Brooklyn, and his name is Daniel Arsham. He's a visual artist, and he does a lot of work in Brooklyn and New York City, but also elsewhere. What I find interesting about Daniel and why we continue working together is he's an artist who's actually colorblind. He sees, as he describes it, he sees the world really in terms of white, gray, black, deep black. And what I think that this has done, or what we think this has done, I'm not a scientist, but I think that it's given him an incredible sense of depth perception in the world, but also when it's applied to stage and to stage space. I think that he has a really unique facility for seeing light and space on stage. So the first time that we started working together, he said, "What the hell are those things on the side of the stage?" And I was like, "What are you talking about?" He said, "You know, the people run on and off, and they sort of run off and they disappear and they come back on and reappear." And I thought, "Oh, he's talking about the wings in the stage." And you know, it's a very artificial construct, the idea of wings. So maybe you have like 100 swans and swan-like, and then they all run off to the next scene and they exit. But aside from architectural features like doors, elevators, stairwells, portals, the resemblance of wings are kind of, it's sort of an artificial construct to enter and exit. So this was Daniel's first observation about the stage, and when I invited him to propose a space on stage, he said, okay, so a lot of stage space goes like this. It follows the logic of a vanishing point. And his proposal was to put a huge cube on the stage, a large cube with two walls that dominated the stage and that divided the stage. So what this did was a few things, and it was also a duet. So he thought cube, two walls, divide the space, sort of invert the perspectival space. And we started making a dance called Replica with a friend of mine named Judith Sanchez Ruiz, who was born in Havana in the 70s. I'm missing some slides, so that's another interruption, but we'll live. Okay, so we give it away. Here's the slide. So the walls break. So let me explain a little bit. In Daniel's view here, the white scale, the black scale, and the gray scale all sort of blur into one another. So eventually the walls disintegrate and are made to look less like a 3D sculpture and more like 2D surfaces. And he does that sort of through graphic lighting. These lines on the floor were vectors. He kind of extruded the edges of the cube out a little bit to divide the space into three playing areas. So you can see the figures kind of stepping in and out of the light here, and they become not only lit and unlit, but kind of black and white. So that was another part of his visual design concept. Another element which kind of developed as we were researching this piece was we decided that the piece, I use the word, usually when pieces are reproduced, I use the word iterate. So we could say iteration. And instead of just doing a show or making a dance and doing a dance and touring the dance and kind of treating it as this product which can be reproduced, this idea of iteration seemed to me that it can have a different life over and over and over again. So the way that Replica iterates is we project past images of its performance onto the two walls of the cube. So the longer the life of the piece and of the production, the more possible projections it could have. So the longer that you keep the dance alive, the more that it can kind of multiply. And the public is invited to see those iterations through projection on stage. So this is an example of Replica being performed in Atlanta, and then projections of its past life are iterating on the walls in front. I'm like so nervous right now. I feel like half the slides have been deleted, but we're going to be okay. Okay, so we're skipping around. But so then this is an example of how Replica we're seeing a duet projected onto two sides of a cube, so the duet is doubled. And then we're also mirrored along this seam here. And I worked closely with Daniel on the projection design here. So we're seeing eight figures who are the figures who dance in the piece, but this kind of multiplication of the piece as it goes along. And then the other thing I wanted to point out is that his sculptural surface erodes as the piece is performed. It's a 60-minute dance. And about right at the midline, or right at the center seam, the walls start to come apart. So projection onto a sculptural surface is really different than projection that we're seeing right now. So this projection is onto a screen, a perfectly great screen. But as soon as you're projecting onto a 3D surface, it brings about this other kind of topography too. So we're seeing kind of edges and enclaves of the 3D surface. And then you're probably, I don't know if it's clear on this slide, but you can also see that the projected image goes through. So it actually kind of penetrates the three-dimensional object. There's also, we work through technical theater to also just show the walls as they are and without digital imagery. So this is just the way that the walls are captured with stage light. And immediately what's beyond the cube, at least in stage space, kind of takes on a black void or sort of a, so the negative space sort of, I think, exudes a kind of mystery because there's not matter back there. And so I think that in stage space, as soon as there's that black space, it almost creates a sense of vacuum. So another premise, as we went along, Daniel proposed that that there would be no such thing as an entrance or an exit in this piece. So his contribution kind of went beyond scenic or beyond scenography. He said, why do people always come on and off the stage? how about if when the dance starts, the dance starts? So it proposes another kind of performativity or performance logic, which is once you're in, you're in. Once the production has started, there's no kind of offstage entering and exiting. As we developed, we also decided to consider lighting this space from behind. So from the space that one can't see, we decided to also use a shade of white light that Daniel determined, and also to highlight this absent space or the space that the public can't see and use it as a to kind of invert the sense of projection through stage light. And Daniel, I found it interesting, this slide is a little bit warmer in its color temperature. So it's interesting because Daniel, I think again with that, with the way that he sees color and senses depth perception, he makes very unconventional choices in tone when he's working with light. I think because we were in our mid late 20s and we needed cash, and I think we needed to. There were a lot of reasons, but we basically, the thing about Replica is that it doesn't say no as a piece or as a production. So, if Replica is invited to be performed, we just say yes and we figure it out. So, if there are two people, if there is the scenic element, and if there's 20 by 20 space, which is a very very small amount of space, then we can say yes to Replica. So it produces these unusual iterations. This is an example of Replica being performed in Lower Manhattan. And so no stage light and no stage projection were possible in this case, but the kind of ethos of the piece was, and Bonnie was talking just really briefly earlier, she made a comment about the morality of form. So we always start with kind of a design element as kind of a fundamental principle for organizing the choreography, but dramaturgically, the idea was never say no when this dance is asked for. But then also dramaturgically, what we wanted to do here was Daniel has a little bit of an architecture inclination, although he's not he doesn't have an architectural background. He located the vertex, not only just the spatial vertex, but latitudinally and longitudinally, the vertex of two buildings downtown that he found resonant. So these are two structures designed by an architect named Gordon Bunshaft, who is a modernist architect and who Daniel kind of quarrels with. He has sort of a certain aesthetic, a very uncompromising modern aesthetic, and Daniel's always kind of trying to tweak the codes of modernism a little bit to the side, a little bit. So he found the midpoint of this between these two buildings, and we decided to orient orient the production in relationship to the way the sun grazes along these two skyscrapers. And that was his kind of answer again. I think that we can kind of see in this slide, it's to his eye, there's this kind of, there's what's lit and what's not lit, so kind of lit and shadowed. I think this was his answer to sort of how do we light without lighting, or just by using what's there. A little bit more going on here. Another element which emerged was following the performance of this work, we decided to leave the visual ephemera just in public. Because you know this is a very financial community of New York City in this part of Lower Manhattan, and we started noticing through site visits. Okay, well, you know, moms, dads, children, and all kinds of and there's a huge sort of surge between 8:30 and 9 a.m. and then another surge after 6 p.m. like between 6 and 8 p.m. And oftentimes it's very family oriented. So we decided to leave the rubble or the detritus of the piece in space. And actually, it was just left for the public to kind of encounter and to make their own impressions of. So sometimes kids would kind of play in and out of it or jump in and out of it. And I don't think we had a necessarily an intention behind what this would or wouldn't yield, but the kind of afterlife of the design elements were left just very exposed to the public. So quite honestly, if someone had stolen these the ephemera of the piece, that would have been okay too, is we could, you know, it can, they have to be recast for each performance anyway. So this kind of ethos of there's this disposability with the performance, and if it's going to have to be remade anyway, then there, why not just leave it for a visual encounter after the dancing is done? So following this was in about 2008, 2009, Daniel and I went on to work together. I found his use of materials, his proposal beyond just materials and beyond space, but also the kind of ethics and performative ideas behind his contributions were really invigorating. So the next time I invited him to collaborate for stage, what he decided to do was to say, okay, this is going to be a solo. So immediately he started determining the scale of performers in a work. So really kind of embracing performance beyond just visual contributions. And he then said that his material contribution would be only one element, which is a 12-foot roll of photographic paper. And I said, okay, great, well, I can't wait to work together and to get this on and to do our performance research together and everything. But he said, no, I'm done. Like I've said, it's the number of people in the space and the material, and that's it, and you're on your own this time. And I said, well, all right, but it's, so there are, again, the collaborative relationship keeps changing every time, and I think that's another part of the ecology of our work together, is that there's always a changing element. So what I decided to do was to kind of exhaust the possibilities for his material use, and I think something about disposability from this past production was on my mind. So, and also it's paper, it's like highly flammable. Of course, theaters are gonna say no to it and all of that. But so disposability was a little bit on our mind here. What we came up with was 20 landscapes for the paper. So the paper would physically change, the contours and the landscape of the paper would change every time. But the rule, or sort of the rule-based element of this, is that it can only be, it can't be manual manipulation of the paper. So the paper and its materiality had to kind of choreograph the figure. So kind of reversing the roles there a little bit. You can kind of see these glacial breakoffs of the paper, and it goes immediately from 2D to 3D to more sculptural form. Eventually, the material swallows the figure entirely. So it's that also inverts a little bit of the role between scenic, I'm just sort of saying scenic in quotes, or material contributions to the stage and the performer. So it's this kind of swallowed dancer or swallowed figure and wearable scenography that happens. So that's another example of our work together. We went on again to, I invited him again to collaborate on a stage work. And what, as we went deeper together, what fascinated me was his increasingly harsh critique of some of the rules of American modernism. And I thought, okay, well, this is where, you know, let's see where this iterates, or how does this go further? I started to invite Daniel for some musical reflections as well. Again, so this is asking a visual artist to contribute beyond just visuality and really start to take apart dance and dance as it's presented on stage in different ways. So we located a piece of music from the early 1970s called Y Patterns. And it's a work by Morton Feldman, who was a part of the New York School of Composers. And actually at this institution, at the New School, John Cage taught for for many years. And actually, my friend and my colleague Philip here, who I hope you'll talk to afterwards, has done some really fascinating work with Cage's legacy at this institution. But there's a Cage-Feldman connection, and there's also a Cage-Feldman chance operations connection. And I've never worked according to chance or by chance procedures. And I think that oftentimes, when we talk about that legacy in, or these legacies in composition with dance, theater, and visual art, we talk about the names, but we don't use the word chance. And the fact that chance was kind of this underlying governing structure of how composition happened with these artists. So I took this piece of music and I said to Daniel, what do you think of Why Patterns? And he said, well, I think it's totally hard to translate this to a public today. I think that there's little patience, toleration, interest, understanding for what's going on here. What if you talk about chance in a new way? So what if you use gaming or sports even as a what if you draw a line between chance and sports? So what we did was, or what he did, is he proposed basically a game field on the stage. So it could be tennis, could be ping pong, could be football. But he proposed a field, so sort of a stage within a stage with borders and everything. And his design scheme was to go from point to line to plane. So sort of, frequently stage space is rectilinear. It's usually a 3x4 rectangle or thereabouts. So what he was proposing was a square, 32x32. And the first thing that happens is a single ball is introduced from off stage. And the performers have to move these objects, again, without using their hands. So this performer is using their breath to kind of locomote the material object throughout the space. Just to cut to the chase, Daniel is kind of a trickster. There are three interruptions in the project. So at unsuspected moments, there are these floods or these deluges of, we go from one or from kind of the singular to the exhaustive or to the totally overpopulated in very short amounts of time. So 10,000 ping pong balls fly down from off stage when the performers lose the game. And it's four performers, so there are teams. There's it's actually been performed in many, many different ways, but usually two men and two women, and we form games that night, and then the losers of the game have to sort of get this rush of ping pong balls. Compositionally, what then happens is we have to figure out a way for an evacuation to happen. So the space is sort of flooded or exhausted, maybe overpopulated. And then using many kinds of contours of the body, we start to irrigate the balls or the materials out of the space, outside of the frame. And that sort of takes its time and it's done in concert with the music. What then happens is we take apart the space that we inscribed. So these borders, or these kind of 2D elements, then kind of dislodge from themselves, and they're then used to kind of rake, and again, to evacuate the space out a little bit. And then we go a little bit further, and we go from taking the space apart to then going into the vertical plane and actually creating more kinds of games. So you see these kind of goal posts here. And you know, a series of duets and all kinds of things happen and unfurl. The production continues, and this idea of going from one, from nothing to one to overload, and then back down to zero, iterates. But Daniel again interrupts. So there are three interruptions, three deluges that happen. And the compositionally, one of the things that occurs is we go from a scale of 32 down to one. So, and ideally, or depending on how the game goes, to have an empty space at the end, just at the small unit of one. So following this project, maybe parallel to this project, I started to, I guess, maybe multiply or extend what I find to be still really an inspiring process, which is to invite, and it really feels like invitation, kind of a generosity, where just inviting visual artists to propose something on stage or in space, sometimes for the first time, and sometimes without any prior knowledge at all to conventions of theater or dance, and just sort of see what is on the mind of visual artists today, and how can they contribute, and how can they turn the dial for what's going on in dance and theater, and also to get out of this word kind of scenic or scenography, but to really use and to invite visual artists to enhance the stage. And I think Paul Juden is here, and he's worked on some of these projects, and it gets really hairy. It's like you get theaters saying, what are we doing? You know, are all of those 10,000 ping pong balls like fireproofed? And, you know, are there, or so it's pushing materiality, but also the visuality of what can be pulled off on a stage. So I wanted to talk about, Daniel's a very unique collaborator for me, but I wanted to talk about a couple of other applications of that process, which is inviting a visual artist to basically create a space and then to respond to it. I had a chance to work with an artist named Lee Ufan, who was born in Korea in the 1940s and then moved to Japan shortly afterwards. And his work is a lot about the severity of the material world that we don't always look at, and sort of a conflict between natural materials, stones, water, even materials like cotton sometimes, versus human-made materials such as steel, other kinds of stone, things like this. So Lee Ufan had a retrospective at the Guggenheim about 3 years ago, and he made a kind of monument in the rotunda, which was called Dialogue, and it's about some of the conflicts between Korean and Japanese history, which is very fraught with conflict, and he lived through some of those periods. So what he proposes on this, what he proposed in this installation was two very, very large boulders and two steel plates, which are kind of canted off-center. There's about 20 centimeters between them, and they're very precariously kind of kissing at the top. So it's kind of an allegorical piece, which is talking a lot about sides which don't speak to each other, communication which may not happen, and a sort of severe yet delicate meeting point along the middle. And there are two components to this project that happened. One was to take his sculpture as is and kind of treat it, confront its materiality. But the other was to look at I was fascinated to learn that this artist did one sort of performance, and he wouldn't have even called it a performance, but there was in 1969 at the Tokyo Expo, he did this action, which was he took three sheets of paper and exposed them to the elements, really just kind of in the street and in the square out in front of the museum. So very politically charged time in that city. And he pinned them and sort of fought with the paper, which was exposed to, you know, traffic and wind and the outdoors and whatnot. And he really kind of braced the paper to the floor, trying to keep the paper on the ground, trying to pin it, trying to make a physical imprint onto the page just with his body. And then he brought the sheets of paper indoors and exposed them as artworks. And really the only, you know, it was very hard to resolve. There was sort of 50 years of his visual work on view, and sort of this one really off-key piece. I don't want to say off-key, that sounds so. There was one of these pieces was not like the others. He had performed, and also there was very little documentation of it, just this photograph and maybe one other photo. So I actually asked his permission to imagine, I would say reimagine, the physical act that happened with the paper and to make a choreography around it called On Vanishing, because he had he really had these two photographs and his physical memory, but the act itself was very resonant. So he said yes, but on a couple of conditions, and I worked closely with him on it. But the idea of then, there are a lot of politics and valency, I'll say valencies around the word reenactment in performance and in performance art these days, and especially in the last 10 years, this I think has come to a very productive vertex, which is, and in, to be honest, I'm making a I'm trying to distinguish here between performance art and dance and theater, and maybe we can place this on a continuum together, and then maybe this can, we can have a little conversation about it afterwards. But restaging in dance and theater tends to have a certain connotation versus reenactment in documentary film and in performance art has a total other polarity. And so in the medium of dance, I wanted to talk about really the politics of reenactment with an artist's permission, and kind of the word that I'm using in this case was reimagining, because an artist said, yes, you can use this source material as a point of departure for choreography, you know, but don't be pretending you're Liu Fan and you're in Tokyo in 1969 and pinning this down. So really, I saw this vertex between restaging and reenactment as a productive point of dialogue. So there were many interpreters in this. I spent about a year or so working on it and reimagining what the actions might have been of pinning this paper and performing on this paper to kind of keep it to the ground. So the piece On Vanishing is not a simple one. It's kind of dealing with materiality in a work called Dialogue, which is this sculpture here, but then inserting as a parenthesis this reimagining of a very, very contrasting element, which is paper, and it's really its lightness and its ability to be marked and to be formed by movement, whereas steel and stone, you know, I guess you could make a mark in steel, but that was not my physical take on it. So this was inviting, or I guess maybe harnessing the creative potential of an artist's contribution in another way. I want to talk about a couple of other visual collaborations which were meaningful. I had a chance to work with an artist that was much closer to my generation and also to the dancers that I work with. An artist, a Cuban-American artist born in Atlanta named Anthony Goicolea, who in the early 1990s was known very much for his play and his kind of multiplication of himself as an early adolescent. There would be photographs, not dissimilar to this, where he photoshops, you know, sometimes dozens of versions of himself into a single frame, kind of enacting these adolescent fantasies. And Anthony is coming from a very strong and very grounded visual background, but also from a very clearly, and also a very empowered LGBT background. I mean, he is, I give Anthony a lot of credit because he's out, his sexual orientation is present in his work, and there's a kind of an aesthetic dialogue around the identity, or the multiple identities that he is performing inside of his photography. So I came to Anthony and said, would you consider working for stage for the first time? And what we conceived of together was kind of a live animation of his, of these early self-portraiture pieces of his. And so we cast a piece to, we cast five people who looked very much like Anthony, and he actually performed in it. So the visual artist who was the sonographer and also the subject of this photographic material, then kind of became a performer for the first time. And then he was surrounded by dancers and performing artists who looked a lot like him. And it was kind of a way to animate or to reimagine a body of photographic work and to give it a life on stage. So it was sort of artist as point of departure, as sonographer, as subject, as performer, and kind of turning him into a kind of a whole planet around which to make a dance production. This is another example of that piece. The piece and the sonography kind of flip around different axes during the project. Another artist that I was working with recently, who was born in Iraq and whose parents moved to Tel Aviv in the late 1950s. This is an artist by the name of Irit Batsri, who works in immersive video installations. So I invited her to, again, to think about stage or performance space for the first time. And what she created was these two projections, differing projections. So this is an example of a two-channel video installation. And the projections happen on, it's a space in which there are 90 degree angles, three white walls, but the projections kind of blur and mate in the middle to create a third composite image. And she also devised, there's a little bit of, I'm not sure if this is so visible in the documentation, but through projection design, she created a way to have a shadowless stage or sort of a shadowless performance space. So that also led to other productive elements for movement and for choreography. So I guess if I could kind of sum up, where my work is these days is really asking how visual art and dance can sort of collide, or I guess I'll use the word, how visual art and dance can kind of mate and collide. And usually pretty omnivorous about whether it's stage or gallery or theater or museum. And I think that these are different vocabularies and have different technical considerations, but I guess it's sort of a little bit of the more the merrier approach, and not being so strict about what can or can't happen visually on a stage. So I went a little bit over, but I wanted to also thank Bonnie and also thank Jennifer for inviting me to do this. And if people want to play the piano or or use the other microphones. But for dialogue, because the... So is anyone in the visual studies program here at the New School or in the... Because there's a visual studies program, a media studies program. Or are there... Now, are there people studying performance or forms of performance or movement here in the... Wow, okay. I think you're a majority. I think you could keep Congress open. but there are a lot of performing artists in the room. That's great. Is there, and also dear friends in the room, dear colleagues in the room. So is there maybe I could introduce, and this is a point of departure. Do you see it as a continuum between dance, theater, performance, performing arts? Are these terms, is it fair to say that this is a continuum? Is it a slippery border between all of them? Can we work in multiple forms at the same time? Maybe I can just open that out. Sort of dance, theater, performance art. Where do we fall within these media? Yeah.
I'm definitely interested in slipping around and like sliding around between all of them, but for me it's neither about ignoring the boundaries between these things we call dance and theater and performance, and more recognizing, nor about leaving them intact and just working in one or the other, but more about recognizing how these divisions are like a bit arbitrary, or like their specific historical and social context and how they come about and like working to take them apart or take those divisions apart.
And do you make work too, or do you?
Yeah. I've done a lot of theater, but now I'm more interested in the performance that visual artists are doing, and also like post-dramatic theater and.
Did you say post-dramatic theater and visual art performance?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's interesting because there are now festivals and platforms in New York that really, the term visual art performance, I think is a relatively recent term, or maybe, so I don't know if there are thoughts around that, but visual art performance, I think I would be interested to know if that's more of an artist's applied term, or if that's a curatorial lens, or if that's a, I think that the performa biennial, okay. So is that term, that term might be born from the performa biennial, or born from the performa biennial. Yeah. Okay. And are there venues on campus where, because if you're making work, or if people are making work, are there places where you guys rehearse or perform, or what are those places? Yeah.
Well, we're in one of them. A lot of times we use this space to perform.
Okay.
Because you asked a question about visual studies, and I actually wish somebody else who is in my class is here. Danny is here somewhere. But what you were talking about earlier, like notions about like linear perspective and how the stage operates and things like that. I wish that I'm a student of the new director of the visual studies is what it's called, department.
Mm-hmm.
Not department, program. And I just like talking about the slippages in between like. How performers talk about their craft, how visual artists, how art historians talk about visual art, like what the slippages are. But I was interested in what you were talking about because of the ways in which the material of her class that she's offering right now is very much, you know, we talk about like moving from like space as aggregate to space as like mathematicized and abstracted and things like that. And we're in visual studies very much talking about like organization of bodies, organization of space, in a way that's like very, I think, very smart and like very much interdisciplinary. And then it goes to like humanism and like Cartesian dualism and like the Cartesian subject. And like there's all these wonderful, like, I don't think it's a spectrum. I think it's like a weaving, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Which is like, I think her class is doing a really awesome. I wish she was here because like she would have, I think, lots of things to say about what you talked about.
Great. Well, but so to go with you, there are a lot of choreographers and performing artists who are using space and using their bodies and embodying space in increasingly personal, increasingly political, and increasingly interwoven ways. So, yeah, that word kind of works for me. The interwoven element. I think that interdisciplinary is often kind of, it's a word that is very broadly applied in academia, interdisciplinary, and certainly at practitioners too, and it's useful as well. But something about, you know, it's since you brought up space, you're right. I think that choreographers, visual artists and others, maybe even architects or classmates of yours are working with space in different ways, but also, I don't know, do we find that space even, is that already, sometimes the abstraction element that you mentioned, I think that a lot of colleagues of mine and friends are, I see so many turns away from abstraction, actually, in just to talk about dance and maybe, I think that questions of embodiment are really on people's minds in choreography these days, but, and how to embody a space. Has anyone heard of the artist Tino Segal? Or A few, maybe, tentative. Okay, so Tino Segal is a, he has a background in choreography and also in economics, and there are a series of very, very complicated ways in which he's applying live bodies in space and kind of confronting the economy around which live bodies and the actions are reproduced. And actually, I think he might have been the first artist to sell live actions within a visual arts system. So that's also, I kind of wanted to put that out there if we're talking about a spectrum. There are usually mixed and kind of controversial responses to the body of work he's made. Yeah, but
since you were involved in the founding of these major spaces for performance, Shea Bushwick and Center for Performance Research, you're well aware of the whole problem of funding and critics and venues and everything that even that segregate the, you know, dance and visual art performance and theater into, you know, there are different critics, different funding, different spaces. One of the big issues with Performa is the fact that no theater people are involved in it, mm-hmm. even though visual art performance has moved toward theater. So how do you deal with those problems on a practical level when the institutionalization is often, you know, has established patterns in funding and criticism and everything, whereas the spaces like the ones that you're involved with have broken all these borders?
So I think that thanks, Bonnie. I think that there are other cities in the United States where it's easier than in New York City or even in Brooklyn to sustain artist-run space. That's kind of the first thing I'd like to say, is if you look in, and just maybe brainstorm with me, Atlanta, Detroit, areas of Chicago, Philadelphia, there, it's really, I see so many more artist-run spaces that perhaps haven't even formed nonprofits. And the sort of the vitality around artist-run space, which it could be oftentimes artists living in their space and sort of this live-work dynamic actually is becoming harder and harder to come by in this city and in these five boroughs and with these zonings. So it's harder to, it seems like if live-work, maybe that's another continuum, if live and work are happening, are two ends of a continuum, my perspective is that in this city, it's becoming harder to live and harder to work. But I think that the artist-run space element is most vital. I think the fewer rules, the better. I think the fewer rules, the better. I moved here in 98 and then permanently in 99. And in the first 3 years that I was living here, spaces were just closing. Spaces were closing, and it. I don't like to take a lot of credit. Actually, I think that I tried to connect the dots or help connect the dots financially, a little bit, but it wasn't all me. And I think that. As soon as there is this decision to sort of be and exist in the nonprofit sector, the thing is that there are a series of, you know, some people are saying that this country is better positioned these days than in United Europe because the tax code encourages charity. So whether that nonprofit is an art space or a church or a university, there's this kind of tax incentive to, which is not built into other countries in the way they're governed. I think though that the art space thing, just because that's sort of what you asked, I think the I think the fewer rules, the better. I think the fewer rules, the better around how space should be happening.
Thank you for your talk and the interesting aspects of your work that you've shown us. I was curious about an overall theme I've gotten from your presentation, which is about closing. And I haven't seen the tablet yet with the dance on it, but I was wondering what your thoughts are about the closing of our perceptual frame through technology, especially as we look ever more closely at our small devices and lose touch, perhaps, with the larger spaces we're in. That's why your exercise with scanning the room was so interesting and so awakening. Do you have any thoughts about what's next in terms of the spaces we're inhabiting as creative people, whether those are getting smaller and closing, in a sense?
Well, I'm not sure how qualified I am to answer that, but if everybody could do this with me, like look up way, 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 way beyond your eyelids. Like, yeah. Actually, don't look up at the ceiling. Go kind of like this. Like, look up way, 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 way up beyond your eyelids, almost to the point that your eyes have to close. I've heard that's a really good stretch because of the amount of time that we're looking like less than a foot away from a screen, like for much of the day. So the cell phone element and the amount of time that we're looking at a mobile screen or a computer screen is actually, just in terms of, I guess I'll answer your question visually. I've read that it's creating a muscular, like a neuromuscular deterioration, and that we should all be stretching like that. I don't know. No, actually, that the visual cortex should be is a muscular system that we're losing flexibility with because of the nature of the technology that we're using. That's something that really fascinated me when I read it. And it's also not something we do in yoga classes or even in dance or dance classes or yoga classes, but I think that that's related to visual, to our visuality, for sure. So, you know, maybe closure, like maybe we should lift our eyes to the point of closing them. I don't know.
Hi, thanks for coming. Leah said something earlier about like how we, through I guess like our social standings, we label things as performance or theater or dance. And it's interesting, the idea of having no rules, to me. And the first thing that it made me think about, though, was that in the establishment of no rules, you're also creating a rule. And so I'm just curious as to how you and your process of trying to, you know, not engage with a specific regimen, maintain regimen, because it seems to me that in generating a product, you need to have those steps of, you know, having a basis of when something begins or ends, or, you know, when you're moving. And I've done some performance, but to me, as like a singer and songwriter, I see a clear progression of a song. So for me, I feel like maybe in music, perhaps it's different, or maybe it's going towards a new place where we can just be hearing music and sound the way it will progress. But in terms of your work, I'm just curious, in the establishment of no rules, how you maintain a sense of composure.
Yeah, okay, so the way I'm thinking about making dance these days, or the way I'm thinking about making choreography these days, is to use the design elements from another medium as like the script. So it feels like I want to qualify my comment on no rules as being more about art space and zoning and how to be, you know, how to have space. I think instead of no rules, I should say the more the merrier. So that if there's art space in your living room, or if there's art space at the new school, or if there's art space with nonprofits, this is all good. Or outdoors, like the more the merrier. But I guess I'd just respond by saying, I'm trying to figure out a language, a new language every time, I'm trying to find out a new language every time. And that's about using another medium, usually a visual medium, as the script for a dance. So it's kind of like saying, you know, you're driving down 8th Avenue and you're using like Atlantic Avenue. You're using that, you know, those traffic lights or those rules. So it sort of feels like this blending of, you know, using another art form as the script for dance. And I don't know if it feels like more a question of plumbing or like using this other kind of plumbing. But the rule thing, I just meant, Bonnie was sort of asking about art space, and I think that's really connected to how this city develops. So so I guess just the more the merrier would be my feeling. Hey, Neil.
Hi, I have one more question regarding process of collaboration. And I don't think you mentioned about the use of sounds in your work. So I was wondering if it's a collaboration between choreographer and visual artist, who would get to decide what kind of sounds would sound you'd use? Or even if it's ambient, how would you get to that decision of not using any sounds intentionally?
Yeah, you're right. I really didn't address sound very much. That's true. In this presentation, I wanted to focus more on sort of the visual order of the dance I'm making. But, you know, I can just speak personally. I tend to think of the sound of a work as integral, but it usually comes really late in the game. That's just for me, and probably just for some reason. The sound comes kind of after the visual world and after the movement elements for me. There are probably exceptions to that rule. I guess I just lied. I guess the Y Patterns piece used sound as like a point of departure. I think that it's late 1940s, early 1950s where dance and music kind of decoupled. I think that these days the media that an artist chooses as square one, or the media that a dance artist chooses, it could be a video or it could be their body and their movement. I think that where we are now is really a result and is very indebted to the past 60 years of sort of this dance music question. But you're right, today I just focused on mostly the visuals. Neil, you had some
thanks.
You had some thoughts.
Well, I think this is all really fascinating, and I'm wondering if you could speak to for us, for the students here, for all of the students here, including myself, what I'm always interested in hearing an artist speak to the why of why they're doing what they're doing. Like, you've told us a lot about what interests you and the kind of the refined aspects of what. So what is the value of that? And I'm not asking that in a challenging way. I'm just really curious to hear any artist like put that into words, like the function, the value, the why of these concerns.
Yeah.
What does it do for us?
Okay. Well, so Neil, I'm glad you're pointing this conversation it seems like there's an ethical dimension to what you're asking too, and I think that at a certain point, at a certain point on the road, an artist is going to run into usually the why category has to do with art and ethics. So this piece called Y Patterns, I'm just going to use that as a diving board. I think that the Y in Y Patterns is a formal Y.
It's a very formal question and a compositional question and a kind of what's at stake for music composition question. And for me, I think that for me, the question is a blend of aesthetic concerns with a much more socially motivated concern. And I think I'm talking about a bridge. So why reach for new aesthetics in dance is something I think a lot about. And why do that? I think part of it is just pure sort of curiosity, interest, love, I'm just gonna say that I'm gonna create another continuum. Over here is more of like a curiosity, interest, love. I love that dance looks new, or I love it when dance looks new. But on the other end of the spectrum might be, I believe that dance and poetry are some of the media in this country that really have the least access, space, funding, possibility for reproduction. And so somewhere between just my interest in doing this as an artist, I guess lies the ethical question, which is, I'll run through this. Like on this laptop, there's probably iPhoto, iTunes, iMovie, iWord, blah, 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 blah. You know, this kind of, there is this accessibility of music, photo, film, image, much more readily accessible, and kind of this transaction of it, that I would even say is it's much more broadly disseminated, or iBook even, just to, so it goes on down the line, but my sense is that dance and theater are media which are not as digitally accessible, and that there's a super direct link between that lack of distribution channel and the economy that the artists in these media tend to live. So that gets me on a super kind of why level. That's not formal at all. It starts to become sort of socioeconomic, in fact, which is why dance, theater, and poetry kind of really end up on this lower, in a lower economic bracket, and with less economic agency than other media. And so I don't know, I oscillate between, I don't know, just to be like, I like how it looks, and that's why I kind of want to push over here. But also, I think that there's kind of this intense, continuing to choose dance and theater and these elements. There, it ends up being very hard economically to reconcile it. So my work is kind of always scaling between.
It's making me think just of that if it's something that isn't being valued and therefore isn't being supported, that there's a tremendous lack of it and we need it.
Right.
Like it's not there enough for these various reasons, or but so therefore there's a lack, we're lacking it. This makes me think of this exercise you just had us do with the eyes. Like,
yes,
we are doing this so much that we are lacking that. And if we want to be able to see the world or experience the world, we have to open that up too.
Right. So, Interesting.
Yeah.
But how do you reconcile that with the attack on spectacle now that's going on?
Mm.
The move against spectacle in favor of social practice. So that theater's under great attack because of that, and I don't know if dance really is, but certainly theater is.
Well, I think that, let me just go with you on that. I think that other dance and theater artists, and I can't so much speak to this, but other dance and theater artists are doing some very intensive work around Occupy, and the Occupy movement, not only as a social phenomenon, but as a movement, and how that those uses of space, of organizing, of being in public space, and in some cases, performativity and spectacle, how that tilts the dial in a whole other way. And it very much outside the realm of theater or commercial theater. So I think that there are artists who are addressing it in a different manner, and I'm not sure how it reconciles, but I think that there are other movements, like really within the past 4 years, that are leading to large discovery for other artists. Occupy doesn't have a box office and doesn't have iTunes or doesn't have that.
I have a pretty practical question. Yeah. I'm interested in when you started out producing your own pieces. I founded a theater company a year ago, and what I found is the most challenging and sort of maddening is just actually getting the pieces to people and working with different venues and making it happen. And I'm just wondering what it was like when you started out. I mean, did you have like a great support network to help you through it, or was there a lot of trial and error? And if there was any time where it became really, really challenging, or you hit a wall that you weren't quite sure that you were going to be able to get past in terms of actually, you know, producing the pieces?
I think that so first of all, keep going. Keep going. You should, you know, it's can I ask you a question? You said you founded a theater company. Is it what's the scale of the?
Well, it's actually really relevant to what you were talking about. It's called the Exquisite Corpse Company, and we did this big project last month, and it was a collaboration with musicians and studio artists and playwrights, and we did a retelling of the Odyssey in this huge space. In Williamsburg. So it was just a really big production for a new company. And it turned out great, but it was just, I mean, like when you're talking about the 10,000 ping pong balls that have to be fireproofed, like it just, you know, like on our last night of performance, the fire department called and we had to tear our whole set down like an hour before the show. And it's just stuff like that as like a new artist trying to produce work in Brooklyn was really, just tough.
Yeah. That sounds familiar. Yeah. So, okay. So, let me address your question like in three ways. I never made a dance company, and I think that I worked with certain dance and theater structures, you know, that had all of the machinery, like literally all of the machinery in place. Endowments, boards, da 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 da. And even then, it's not fair to say that. It's an enormous amount of work to continue having thriving nonprofit structures. But I wanted to stay small, and I still feel that my work is a lot about the kind of retapping the practice, and it's sort of between this formal social continuum I've been talking about. But let me just wear another hat for a second. New York does need more art space. New York still needs more art space. And I think that I heard you mention Williamsburg, and kind of Williamsburg, Bushwick, Inwood, some people call it Williamsbush, I call it Williamsbush, it depends on who you talk to. But there still are a lot of spaces and structures and possibilities there that are much more under the radar and much more independent than even, say, Shea Bushwick or the Bushwick Star or Norte Mar. And so I think that you should go for it where you're comfortable and where you're safe and where you're working within your means. Like, I think those are three kind of, I don't know. I'm not in a position to really, I don't really know how you're working, but the comfortable, safe, and within your means are kind of, if you have other people and in this built environment and with scenic elements and stuff, that's kind of what I would say. And actually, in my case, the I'd been making things for about 5-6 years before a nonprofit structure came into the picture. And artists deal with that in the ways that work for them, really. And there are some very, very mature, established dance and theater artists which really do not elect to do a nonprofit structure, and that's fine. So I don't want to say that there's a particular route that is a can or can't. Yeah. Just don't go to spaces where it's like dangerous. that's the other. No, it's like, you know, it's, yeah. You don't want rafters falling on you. And you want, you know.
All right. Well, thank you so much. I think we should continue the dialogue offline. Thanks. Thank you.